And it's that time again in the basement in the woods. You're sitting on the 50 with your pals, Franks and Busby.
Welcome back to the 50 Sports Talk, baby, with Franks and Busby. This is episode 11. Holler at me, big fella.
Oh, yeah.
All right, look, it's really weird.
On remote.
We're on remote. We're doing the responsible thing, being practical, responsible adults, which is very rare for Frankie and I.
Especially me.
But yeah, but he's coming out of a speaker, and it's really weird because he's not across from me right now. So it's strange, but you have to adapt and overcome to the circumstances at hand. So here we are.
Here we are. Yeah, and it looks like we'll be here for another couple of weeks. It seems like just with all the latest stuff coming out from the White House and everything. So just buckle your chin straps. Make sure you have toilet paper, which most of you should have freaking toilet paper because there is none. There's none to be found.
Frankie went TP shopping.
I literally went to the grocery store yesterday just to buy some groceries, just a few little items, maybe $60, $70 worth of stuff, and there was nothing.
Yeah,
to be found as far as toiletries to wipe my tail with. So, I'm a little upset with society right now.
Dude, I Facebooked this, but we're not under a nuclear winter. I mean, there's the food supply is good. No. Crops are still being grown. You don't have to go out and panic buy. I mean, come on, guys.
Well, you don't have to panic buy. Hey, look, it's always good to be prepared, but here's the thing. You should always be prepared anyway.
Right. I mean, nobody's
going to be prepared. have a reserve tank. In the event something crazy was to happen, it's always good to be prepared. It's always good to have money in your savings account. Some of us do, some of us don't. But this should remind you, always be prepared. Prepare yourself for the worst and hope for the best.
I hear you.
That's just how it needs to go. But anyways, going forward off of my rant, we were going to do a little bit of 80s movie trivia.
Yeah, man. We're throwing it back to the old school style summer style show because there's no sports.
We're even going to kick off with it. We're gonna start off a little light. We're going to end a little bit heavier. We've got a guest coming on today. That's going to talk a little bit about the mythical state title,
yes.
Internet champs, baby.
The people's champ, Corner High School Baseball, 5A.
That's it, 5A Internet champs. Hey, if you can't play out the season, at least everybody thought you'd be champions anyway. So, hey, it's good enough for me.
That's right. All right, let's do it. Movies, 80s movies quotes. I'll go first. Are you ready?
Yeah, let's go with it.
What movie is this from? Now, this is part of this quote, because the first part of the quote is very obscene in a very R-rated movie from the 80s. So just keep that in mind. It says, quote, "You don't look like much to me. Opinions vary."
I don't know the movie, but that's a great quote.
Okay, all right, he's out. It's Roadhouse, 1989. Patrick Swayze comes out. He's new.
Yes.
The guy says something really bad to him at first. And then he says, "You don't look like much to me." And he goes, "Opinions vary."
Yes. I know the exact scene.
That's right. All right. You are.
I got one for you. All right.
Okay.
So I got that going for me, which is nice.
Oh, man. Gosh. So I got that going for me.
This is the backside of the quote. It's actually a super, super, super long quote.
Oh, but yeah. Give it to me one more time.
And so I got that going for me, which is nice.
I don't know.
Caddyshack. 1980.
You always drop Caddyshack on me, and I get it wrong every time.
I love Caddyshack. Caddyshack.
It's a good movie.
It's a great movie.
It's not one of my childhood iconic movies, but it is a great movie.
I got into golf, about 14 years old.
Yeah.
So it was like one of the few golf movies that was even out there at the time. So it was, that and Tin Cup.
Well, hey, remind me to do this. I got to get our sound effects back for the booing and the timer. Remember we used to have the timer where it would go, doo, 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 doo.
Yeah.
We got to get that back. Remind me of that. Make a mental note. All right.
Well, since our intern is quarantined right now, too, we'll just have to do with what we got.
Right. All right, here we go. Number two. What's your record for consecutive questions asked? 27. I'm your dad's brother, all right. That's right. He got it. I'm your dad's brother, all right. Macaulay Culkin as Miles.
John Candy and Macaulay Culkin are doing the dialogue.
Oh, it's so good. Such a classic scene.
Oh, fantastic.
All right, I got
one for you. There can only be one.
There can only be one. These are vague. Give me a hint.
There can only be one.
Give me a hint.
I think this is even on the movie poster.
There can only be one.
You might not have ever seen this movie. But it's very popular.
What year?
1986.
I have no idea. Total Recall.
It's a very kind of a singular movie. Highlander.
I have seen that. Good movie. Very good movie.
There can only be one.
Okay, so you hit me. You're one, I'm zip. Here we go.
All right.
This is a layup, man. All of these have been real layups. 1.21 gigawatts. How could I have been so careless?
Back to the Future.
That is correct, my friend. The only thing that can generate that kind of power is a bolt of lightning.
Finish the quote, though, because I think it's Back to the Future 2.
No, it's not. It's not. You got it right. I'm going to give it to you. It's Back to the Future 1.
No, it is Back to the Future, because it's when 1.21 gigawatts.
Yeah.
What was I thinking?
How could I have been so careless? And then he says, the famous, hold on, wait a second, wait. The famous line where he goes, the only thing that can generate that kind of power is a bolt of lightning. Unfortunately, we never know when or where one's going to strike. And Jay Fox turns around and goes, what did you say? And because he's got the flyer, and they actually know the exact time that the bell tower gets struck. So anyway.
Exactly. Now, a little bit of trivia about that word gigawatts. In Back to the Future, that's not actually how the word is pronounced. However, when Christopher Lloyd was discussing, the movie with an actual scientist, that's how the scientist pronounced it.
Right. So interesting.
Christopher Lloyd went with it, and that's why it's called a gigawatt.
That's awesome.
I think it's like a gigawatt or something like that. I mean, it's something, it's pronounced differently. But since Christopher Lloyd heard the scientists pronounce it that way, it's pronounced that way throughout the entire series.
Interesting. Next. Last one. You there?
You should know this one.
Okay.
You should know this one. Because I've got a few of them here. But that's why they call them crushes. If they were easy, they call them something else.
Oh, man. Gosh, I know this.
It's part of that series that you and your brother, series of movies. It's one of those that you and your brother used to always love. It was made in 1984.
I don't know. I'm not on my game today.
I'll drop one hint because I can't let you go out scoreless.
All right.
What number was Peyton Manning in college?
16 candles.
Boom, you got it.
That's actually a really good choice. I'm impressed that you brought 16 candles and Molly Ringwald into the movie quotes.
Don't say, forget about me.
Well, that's Breakfast Club.
But
close.
That's all the same damn thing to me. Like I said, they're all the same movie.
All right, Frankie takes the movie quotes with a score of 2-0.
Yeah.
He actually gave me one.
Today, baby. You know how I am. I've always got more hype when I'm on the road.
All right, let's take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to go over and take a look at our Heisman 2020 Heisman candidates, my friend. We'll be back on the 50 Sports Talk with Franks and Busby.
Welcome back to the 50s Sports Talk. This is the next episode. Now your hosts, Franks and Busby.
All right, you heard Jerry say it. We are back on the 50. Frankie, big fella, let's shout out the sponsor real quick.
Yeah, this segment's actually going to be brought to you by Buffalo Wild Wings of Gardendale. Buffalo Wild Wings of Gardendale right now is doing takeout only right now. But you can make sure you can put in the order, and you still get points if you are a Blazing Rewards member. You'll still get points on your Blazing Rewards. So once the COVID finally releases us from all this dire despair, you'll be able to redeem those points later on down the road.
Awesome.
Which may actually be able to go ahead and redeem them. But anyways, make sure you go visit Buffalo Wild Wings and Gardendale. Get you some takeout food. Take your mind off what's going on. There are no sports to watch, but you know what? You know, it goes great with, a good movie, some good Buffalo Wings to chomp on while you're watching it. So head on down to Buffalo Wild Wings and support our sponsor.
Awesome. That's right. Awesome. Love me some B-dub dubs and all they do for the community around
That's
the
it.
County, baby. All right.
That's it. Support the ones who support you.
That's right. Let's talk about it. Let's talk Heisman frontrunners. We'll go true Frankie style and go 3-2-1, and then I want an honorable mention from you, all right?
I've got my honorable mention, and I've got the 3-2-1 going.
All right, let me hear the number 3.
I actually was going to let you go first on this.
Okay, all right. You always like to let me go first.
I do.
All right, my number 3, really this is an easy list, I thought. It came to me pretty easy. And I bet that at least 2 of these people out of the 4 that I've got, including the honorable mention, will be in New York. But my number 3... hailing out of Alabama, Najee Harris, baby, coming back for his senior campaign.
That's actually a solid pick. You kind of stealing one of my picks here, but yeah, Najee Harris definitely has to have a big year for Alabama to be successful. I know Mac Jones is touted to be one of the Heisman frontrunners also, but honestly, if you want to win at Alabama this upcoming season, in my opinion, it all starts between the tackles and what you can do on the ground. Because, Mac Jones, look, last year he was thrown into a weird situation. One of the best quarterbacks that ever came in, that has came through Alabama, was in front of him. He got hurt. He had some good moments and some bad moments. But I think if you really want to be solid at Alabama, you got to feed Najee Harris the rock, because all he did last year was get stronger as the season went.
Yeah, that's right. He had his biggest games against the best competition, LSU, Auburn. Really kept Bama in LSU and Auburn games, even though they were both losing efforts. He's got everything you need. He's a trucker. He's shifty. He's got hands out of the backfield for a threat there.
To me, he's just an all around back.
Yeah,
he's going to be a top 10 draft pick in next year's NFL draft.
Yeah, I think he did really good with himself coming back to build his stock. He had over 1,200 rushing yards with 13 TDs. The big stat, man, almost 6 yards per carry.
Usually that's a top 10 NFL, stat line, going into the draft, any year that you look at it. And he's coming back for another one. So if Alabama is to be successful, it will be on the shoulders and the legs of Najee Harris.
Yep. 6 yards per carry is big. It's just big for Alabama for him to come back. Who's your number 3?
All right. My number 3 is also an in-state guy, and you're probably gonna get a little upset about it. But in order for this team to be very good, he's got to have one hell of a year, and that's Bo Nix. Bo Nix, if he can get out in front of this season and have some big, put up some big numbers, because, he's in the top 15, according to the CBS stat lines, odds to win the Heisman this year. And if Auburn is going to be successful, which I think they're going to be pretty successful this year, I think Bo Nix is going to have a wonderful year. And if so I think Bo Nix is somebody you have to look at as, potential Heisman, Heisman candidate, because that leap from year 1 to year 2, if you start as a freshman, usually is a big, big leap.
Well, I think you're right about that. I don't think it's a bad pick at all. There's certain questions I have. He played not well at times last year. He played well at times last year, but he was a freshman. The thing with him is, Does he have the playmakers around him? I think that's a question mark going into the Auburn 2020 season. But also, here's the other thing. This was a strong suit for them last year. They lost a lot up front on the line, man. And I just don't know how that's going to stack up.
That's another thing that, you know, we're going to find out just how good Bo Nix really is, because he's going to have to learn how to he's going to have to do some things with his feet. He's also going to have to think a little quicker, you know, when let's just be honest with ourselves. Defensive coordinators in the SEC are pretty much the top defensive coordinators throughout the country now. So the defensive coordinators are dialing up different pressures throughout an entire football game, and he's going to have to be able to recognize those and really do some things and make the players around him better. He's going to really have to do what Peyton Manning used to do up in Indianapolis and elevate the play of the guys around him, because sometimes the guys around him weren't always the best.
Yeah.
So if we see that out of Bo Nix, he's definitely got a shot to win the Heisman. Now, I'm not saying Auburn's going to win a national championship, but I'm saying, you know, the Heisman Trophy is not for how good your team does, but how much did you help your team be the best they could. So that's why I've got him at number three right now.
My number two, Justin Fields out of Ohio State. 3,273 passing yards. Big stat here, 41 TD tosses. I think another year in the system under Ryan Day. They'll probably be in the CFP playoffs, college football playoffs, he's kind of a no-brainer.
Yeah, Ohio State's definitely looking at the college football playoff run this year. You know, Justin Fields came out this last year, had a couple off moments here and there, but you saw just how good he was, because even in the off moments, he was still better than most people.
Yeah, no doubt.
Justin Day, last year was the first year, first full year at Ohio State, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, it was. It was his first really full season to play, which is another reason I had him on the list. I think he's due for a bust out.
Yeah. So, Kirby Smart right now is just kicking his own butt right now, because he let Justin Fields get away. But Justin Fields went up to Ohio State, made a lot happen. I definitely see this being a huge year for Justin Fields. I do not see much coming out of Michigan. I do not see much coming out of really the Big Ten in general.
That's right.
Except for Ohio State. So they should run the table in the Big Ten and definitely find themselves in a playoff spot. And if they do that, Justin Fields will definitely find himself in New York.
Who's your number two?
My number two is actually Trevor Lawrence.
Uh-huh.
Another guy who plays for a team that should run the table in their league. You've got a couple of teams in the ACC that really could give them some trouble at times, because the ACC is getting a little bit tougher. But, Trevor Lawrence, this is his third year in the system. You know, college football playoff appearances, first 2 years, got a national championship. I really don't see anything stopping him except for Trevor Lawrence. Trevor Lawrence is the only person who can stop Trevor Lawrence from really doing great this season and having a shot to win the Heisman.
Well, let me tell you this. My number one, I'll just go ahead and get out of the way. I think it's his to lose, man. My number one, Trevor Lawrence out of Clemson. 3,665 passing yards last year, 36 TDs. He had a rough patch early, but look, this is his junior campaign. He's going to be probably number one overall if all goes well next April. I really think it's his to lose, man. And with, the ACC is
really
getting better,
too,
but they're not
really
there yet.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. I think the ACC, I don't think they're there quite yet to challenge Clemson. And remember this, Clemson's already, from the 16 championship, going to have seniors or redshirt fifth-year guys, plus the 18 ship. They're going to have that recruiting class that have a year under their belt. It's just they recruit elite, and right now there's nobody that's touching them there. And their coaching staff's continuity and their coaching staff, everything's there for them to, again, make another run.
I haven't lost anybody in the last 5 years that would remotely matter from that coaching staff that you usually see. Because, Alabama's experienced, Ohio State experienced it. Any of the national title teams over the past 5 years has experienced some coaching, I won't call it instability, but just people being able to elevate their own selves after a great campaign. This group has stayed together and I don't see anything stopping them from really winning a national championship. Unless, of course, Trevor Lawrence just has a bad year. And like I said, Trevor Lawrence is the only one who can stop Trevor Lawrence.
That's right. All right, give me number one. Here it comes.
All right, my number one is actually Justin Fields.
Justin Fields.
And the reason I got Justin Fields over Trevor Lawrence is because Clemson is more of a complete team than Ohio State, in my opinion.
Yeah.
So if Ohio State has the great year that I expect them to have, it's going to come on the shoulders of Justin Fields. Justin Fields is going to be the guy who is actually going to bring them a national championship, whereas Trevor Lawrence is just going to be a part of a team that was in a national championship.
Right.
So I think, you know, and since this is an individual award and not a team award, this is one of those awards that I think Justin Fields has an edge because he's got more room to, he's got more meat on the bone as far as what he can do to bring them an Natty up there at Ohio State.
Yeah, I think they were 1 year early on their college football playoff berth last year. They played Clemson well. Clemson pulled away. That's depth, and that's also a little extra talent on the roster. But yep, it's the second year. You got revenge factor, all those things that come into play. I think it's a big, like you mentioned, Michigan down again. I really think Ohio State's, it's time for them to shine.
Yeah, I really think you saw, you know, the old Buckeyes. I think you really see them get a shot this year to do something they really haven't done in a long time. That's actually have an undefeated national championship, with the exception of Clemson a couple of years ago.
And LSU last year. LSU didn't get beat last year. Hey, who's your honorable
LSU
mention?
Last year?
No, they ran the table, man.
Didn't they?
Mm-mm.
Oh man, all this COVID talk's got me going crazy. I'm forgetting things already.
Who's your honorable mention?
Honorable mention was actually Najee Harris.
Okay.
That's why I kind of chuckled when you said Najee Harris was your third guy, because I definitely believe Najee Harris is somebody who is, going to have a lot on him. The success runs through Najee Harris in Tuscaloosa this year, and, of course, the defense. But as far as offensive production, Najee, to me, has to average at least 20 touches a game, 25 touches a game. 150 total offensive yards for Alabama to really be successful and beat teams like they have over the past few years.
Yeah. I'm going to get probably a little backlash for this because it seems homerish, but my honorable mention is Jalen Waddle out of Alabama.
That's not a bad pick.
Here's the thing, man. Here's the thing. He's electric. He's a punt returner, kick returner. He's going to be on highlights on ESPN nationally all the time, and plus he's an electric wide receiver. And Mac already showed in the Auburn game that he can get it to him. The kid scored 4 touchdowns, I think, minus the kick return he had. So he's going to give, I think, everybody a run for their money, and could be a dark horse Heisman New York visit for him if he keeps continuing what he's doing.
Yeah, Waddle has that Charles Woodson element to him.
That's right.
This year. Big time special teams guy, big time offensive guy, big play, potential every single time he touches the football. If Mac Jones and him get their timing down pat early in the season, I mean, Waddle could easily take a lot of the pressure off of Najee Harris, which would be good for Najee because, like I said, he's going to be touching the ball a lot anyway.
Right.
That's not a homer pick at all. I mean, that's actually a very solid pick because, until somebody shows that they're better than he is, then, who's better than him? But I've steered away from the wide receiver simply because, I mean, teams are getting pretty good depth in their wide receiving core, especially Alabama. You might only see them touch the football 5 times in a game.
Yeah, I agree. And I normally wouldn't pick a wide receiver, but he's their kick and punt returner. So it evens to me, it sets him apart. So
All right, man. All solid picks though.
Yes, sir. You too. All right. That's it for this segment. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, special guest Coach Josh Hoyle joins us to talk Corner High School baseball and the season that would have been on the 50 Sports Talk. Big fella, give me a little breakout here.
Yeah, this is actually where I leave the podium. So, we can do it so we keep the record straight and – Yeah, we keep the the continuous amount of times I've done this. Go ahead and send me off.
Yes, big fella.
See ya.
Welcome back to the 50s Sports Talk. This is the next episode. Now your hosts, Franks and Busby.
All right, thanks for sitting on the 50 with Franks and Busby. On the line now, my first good friend and corner high baseball coach, Josh Hoyle. What's up, man?
What's going on, man? How are you?
Doing well. Doing fantastic. How y'all doing?
I'm good. This might be my first ever phone interview.
There you go. On the 50. It's exciting. Listen, we appreciate you coming on. Just complete disclosure, we had Josh, Frank, said he would step away because we couldn't figure out a three-way, and we wanted the audio quality to be as good as possible for all of our listeners out there. So he's not going to be on the line, but he is, of course, here in spirit. So we're going to move on. So.
That's right.
All right, man, so obviously with the coronavirus cutting everything short, tell me your feelings about the season that could have been, man.
You know, it's a tough deal, and it's, you really feel for the seniors. I did an interview earlier in the week with North Central News, and I was kind of telling them the same thing. You know, we finished the AAA series against Dora, kind of playing our best ball of the season, and had some guys that really stepped up that were kind of – you know, getting some time too that maybe we weren't really counting on. So, you know, we went from 9, 10, 11 guys to really 13 or 14 we really felt like at any time could contribute.
Right.
And we finished the Door series, and I was told, hey, guys, good job. You know, proud of you, 4-0 in the area. I love you. Get some rest, and I'll see you tomorrow. And then, you know, we come back to school the next day, and everybody's like, hey, they're letting us out. And we didn't see them. So it's that's been tough, you know, just not being with the guys and, you know, kidding around with them and being in the locker room. And, you know, that's the part of it that you really miss, just because there was really no closure. And,
yeah,
you know, we have a group text and we've been able to talk some through that. But, you know, it's just hard to tell a bunch of kids, not even face-to-face, you know, via text that, hey, your season's over. You know, it's one of the hardest things I've had to do. Don't look forward to doing it ever again. But, you know, I just kind of kept telling them that something good's going to come from this. I don't know what it is. But you gotta keep the faith and know that there's a bigger plan and this is bigger than us. And so, you know, the exciting part is, you know, we had the two guys that had already signed, Tanner and Braden.
Right.
But we had 9 total seniors. And I don't wanna jump the gun, but it looks like the other 7 may have gotten picked up this week. So we could quite possibly send all 9 guys to play the next level.
Wow.
Barring, you know, some different things, financials and test scores and all that stuff, see how all that pans out. But fingers crossed, all 9 guys will get to go on and play at the next level. So,
man, that's awesome. That's got to be big for the program, obviously. I know it's huge. That's really cool.
Absolutely. And then that's the thing. You know, I love that part of my job. It's not necessarily, you know, when you go interview for a high school baseball coach job, that's not necessarily in the roles and responsibilities. But it is a part of it, especially these days, that kind of comes with the territory. And I love it. I love forming the relationships with the college guys and seeing those guys that we have that maybe that wasn't a goal to start with, and then they kind of start getting some positive feedback and some things start going, you know, like they want it to go, and then it is a possibility. It's like getting a new lease on life or something, like your career. Just, you know, somebody told you, hey, you're going to live 4 more years. That'd be a pretty cool thing, and that's kind of – not to, you know, sound crazy, but that's basically what they're saying. Hey, you're going to get to play baseball for 4 more years, and up until this point, you weren't going to.
Right. Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. I tell you, man, I didn't realize that it happened that fast for y'all. I mean, you didn't see him again after you talked to him. That's wild.
Yeah, I mean, we literally finished the door game, and, you know, we kind of broke it down, and they got going on their field jobs, and that was it. Because we're trying to get, because I don't know if you remember, there was weather coming in that week, and so we were trying to scramble and get as many of them in as we could, because we knew that we were about to get hit with some pretty bad rain. So I immediately got on the phone with Hayden's coach, Coach Drake, and tried to start figuring out when we could play them. So I was kind of removed from the guys after the game, after, you know, I just told them, hey, proud of you, good job, I love you, get your field jobs done, I'll see you tomorrow. I kind of stepped away to start planning for when we were going to try to get the Hayden series in, and then I was also trying to get updates on their series with Norman Jordan as well.
Right, man. Well, hey, let me mention this. I know that's got to be just tough. I know I commented on Facebook about my senior year, and not, I couldn't imagine not being able to play or finish it, man. Especially that team, you know, the team that y'all have, especially I feel like with y'all, because it's got to be really difficult with all the talent, the potential, and everything that was there, and the momentum that you start building. I know it's rough, so.
You know, the thing that I kind of equated it to, and Josh, obviously not on the call, but he would probably agree with this. And I'm not an Auburn fan, but I've been around a lot of Auburn athletics just because of so many family members that are Auburn fans.
Right.
It really reminds me of the 93 Auburn season. You know, they're on probation, and they go undefeated.
Yeah.
And they don't get to play an SEC championship game. They don't get to go to a bowl game. And people talk more about that season then they talk about the 2010 year when they win the national championship. And I think our culture of America loves what might have been stories.
Yeah, for sure.
And so that was kind of my message with us guys. You'll probably be talked about more because of how all this transpired and went down than if you would have got to finish the season and went on and accomplished your goals and did what you hopefully were going to do.
Yeah.
So not that you're going to live in infamy, but you know, it does give it a little mystique of you know, that team 20 years from now, people will be like, that group right there, they could have went who knows how far. You know, it leaving that chapter open, you know, they'll be talked about for a long time, I feel quite certain.
So, yeah, that's awesome. That's a great perspective. Well, let's talk about mention this real quick. Internet People's Champions, 5A state title. Tell me about it.
Yeah, you know, I was at first, you know, when it kind of started, I got a thing on my Twitter saying, hey, we're going to do this. And, you know, basically this is what it is. You share it and you get to vote and it's like a bracket. And I'm like, okay, that's cool. And so I don't know. I'm sure y'all went on there, but like you only get one vote per account.
That's right.
So
that's right.
I have the Coin Baseball account and then I have my personal account. Mm-hmm. So I get on there, I vote twice and, you know, go a day or so, and I look up again the next morning, and like we're winning or whatever. The kids obviously are going crazy, and they're sharing it, and retweeting it, and
right,
subtweeting it or whatever it's called, and so it kind of starts picking up steam, and we start sharing it on our other social media accounts, and all of a sudden now we're in the second round. Now you know we're in the third round, and now all of a sudden you're in the championship round against Russell and. You know, I told Eric with North Churchill News, I said, you know, it's something great for the fans. It's something that the kids really enjoy, obviously. And it gave PBR a lot of exposure.
Yep.
For what they do with their summer stuff and furthering high school kids and trying to get them placed into college programs. But the thing that really stuck out to me, and this is probably what humbled me more than anything, is that there were literally thousands of people for probably a week and a half, taking time out of their day to get on Twitter or whatever and vote for us in our program. And, yeah, I mean, I get chills thinking about it. To me, that is the most – that's the biggest compliment anybody could give you. It's just – because, I mean, for people listening, I'm sure most people are from around this area, but there's not 1,000 kids in the high school. There's probably not 1,000 kids in the feeder pattern. I don't know, maybe right around 1,000.
And all of that's them a good
don't
point.
Have Twitter accounts. I know a lot of people probably don't have Twitter accounts, but I'm guessing there were a bunch of Twitter accounts made this week just because of that. And, you know, that's the thing that I told them was, I'm going to give them some shirts or something made up just to kind of commemorate it or whatever. I think we get a plaque hanging in the indoor. But, you know, just that people from around the region, not necessarily just our community, you know, thought enough of us to vote for us and to put us in a spot to win it means more to me than probably anything. And,
right.
You know, it's just kind of that proverbial pat on the back that, you know, hey, you're doing the right thing and people are noticing. And, you know, that was another message that I left the seniors with is, you know, they have probably, you know, like the 2016 team that went to the semifinals, you look at a couple other teams that, you know, the 2013 team, I guess, won more games than any team in school history, 2014, went 31-14. And but this team probably has done more to further the culture and the brand of Corner High School baseball than any team before them. Just from a media standpoint, from a coverage, from a, you know, our schedule for next year is done. And I say it's done. There's a couple things that I'm still getting my confirmation from, but you're talking, you're playing Hartsell, you're getting games with Oak Mountain, you're talking to these 7A teams from Birmingham that normally, you know, they may want to try to play here and there, but they're trying, hey, we'll come to y'all, y'all come to us, da, da, da. That just doesn't happen. And that doesn't happen if you're not playing a really, really good brand of baseball. And that's the kind of, the, I guess, the challenge for the group that's coming back and the freshmen coming up is, okay, we've got the gear. Now we can't take a step back. Like, it's got to keep getting better. We got to keep pushing the envelope and moving the needle. So it's exciting. It's definitely an exciting time around the school building and just ready to get back to it and see the kids and get back to work.
Absolutely. Well, you kind of answered my next question. What's next for Corner Baseball? It sounds like that's what's next. Get back to work.
Well, it is. And I told them, you know, I'm a little hesitant right now to send out dates for things just because I just don't know when all this stuff's going to end.
Right.
But our summer, obviously, will lift. It's a big part of that for us. And a lot of our guys play football, so they'll be getting ready for the season, Matt, and I encourage them to play. I think it's good for them to play as much as possible and keep competing and being in competitive situations. So there's some guys that'll do that. Other guys will start getting ready for their summer stuff, whether it be, you know, travel organization or whatnot, different throwing programs, and we'll do some developmental stuff with our 7th and 9th graders. Have to find the time to have a tryout, and then our youth camp is another big thing that we do. It's probably, I guess, our 6th year. We do kindergarten through 6th grade. It's 3 days. We work kindergarten 1st and 2nd in the morning, and then 3rd, 4th, 5th, and 6th in the afternoon. And 3 days, it's a good deal. We try to break it down and partner with the park, and it's open. Parents, coaches, anybody can come out. We just try to give them, you know, they're not going to leave and you know, be all-stars by any means. But if they get one or two little nuggets that they can take and use, you know, then I think it's time well spent. And they get to be with the older guys. And everybody thinks the little ones, you know, are just in awe. It's the, my guys, really, I think, benefit from it more than anything because – you really don't know something until you have to teach it. So when we get our infielders or outfielders or, you know, whatever out there and they're going over drills, my guys are doing the instructing. So it almost helps them further their knowledge of the game, what they're supposed to do and how we do things because they're having to reiterate it and teach it at a very elementary level to some younger guys. So it really helps us. And I tell them guys, these kids, they don't know the difference between you and the Atlanta Braves. Like they can't comprehend the difference.
Right.
They just know that you're the high school team, that you're the older kids, and that they think you're the best thing since sliced bread. So it's a huge blessing for us. We enjoy it. Something we look forward to every year. That's usually the first week of June. I'm still holding out that that's going to stay the same, but obviously we'll blast that out there and get it out to as many people as we can. Yes, hopefully still a busy summer, as long as everything kind of gets back to normal and everybody gets back well and healthy.
Right, absolutely. Man, that's awesome stuff. Awesome information. I'm going to let you run. I know you're busy. I really appreciate you. Franks and I really appreciate you coming on. And
yeah, man, it's a pleasure.
Absolutely. Thanks for everything. And obviously, big ups to this year and moving forward and more success, next year.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me, and look forward to talking to you soon.
All right, man. See ya.
Bye, buddy.
Bye.
See you, man.
And that was our interview with Coach Josh Hoyle of the Corner High School Yellow Jacket baseball team. Great stuff. Great call. That is it for the show. We appreciate everybody. Listen, follow us Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and also visit the website at www.the50sports.com, the50sports.com. Thanks for listening and sitting on the 50 with Franks and Busby.